Alright everyone, welcome back. Previous video, we set up our project, which is pretty simple. We just imported some content from the marketplace, downloaded an audio asset that we're going to use to score our cinematic, and then opened the Forge map, which we're going to create our content in. In this video, what we're going to talk about is Sequencer, the Sequencer editor, level sequences, cinematic viewports, how to enable them, things like that. Just a quick introduction to the Sequencer editor before we start actually getting in there and getting our hands dirty with the Sequencer editor. So our project is up. Let's continue. First thing that we're going to talk about is the use of cinematic viewports, which is a cool feature of Sequencer. It allows you to preview our cinematics in real time, the final result. And we can enable those inside of any viewport. Before we do that, though, I did want to give a quick primer to those of you that are completely new to Unreal Engine 4. Sometimes we may have some artists coming from other disciplines and other industries coming in here, and this is their first time with Unreal, checking out this Sequencer tutorial series and how to create cutscenes, and they may not know how to get around the viewport, which is going to be very important for the rest of this tutorial series. So I'm going to give a quick primer on that. Inside the viewport here, if you hold the right mouse button down, you can rotate the camera around like so. Holding the right mouse button down, you can press W to move forward, S to move back, A to move left, D to move right, Q to move down, E to move up. So there's other ways of navigating around, but this should get you started. Holding the right mouse button down and pressing the W, A, S, and D keys should get you started. So with that, let's talk about cinematic viewports. So any viewport can be turned into a cinematic viewport. Typically, the workflow that I like to have is either have a second monitor with my cinematic viewport so that I can have a full viewport for level editing and construction. But because I'm working on one screen here, I'm going to show you a quick way that we can get around this. If we click this drop down here, the viewport options, under layouts, there's a bunch of different options that we can have to kind of display our windows, our viewports, I should say. I'm going to choose the two panes here. So go ahead and choose that. And it's going to give us two viewports side by side. One of them is a wireframe, which probably not helpful for cinematic creation. So I'm going to click this here and change, well, not that one. No, not that one, this one. This one here, I was looking at wireframe and got ahead of myself here. We're going to change this back to perspective, like so. And in the right viewport over here, we can click this drop down, and all the way down at the bottom, there's an option for cinematic viewport. So the default viewport is what you're looking at now, which is what you do your construction in. Cinematic viewport, it's going to look very similar, but it's going to add some bars across the top and bottom here. It's also going to give us an option over here to display overlays to this viewport. So if I wanted to, I could click this and add some grid lines. I could add title safe and action safe if I wanted to. I could change the colors of these or the size if I wanted to. But we're going to disable all of this for now. We don't need this, but it's there if you'd like to. Across the very top here, we still have our toolbar enabled. Because this is our cinematic viewport, we're probably not going to need grid snapping and things like that inside of this viewport. So we can turn this off if we want to, clicking this viewport options, unchecking show toolbar. So that will hide the toolbar from the top here. Now we still have editor icons in here, such as this warning bad size icon and light bulbs and all kinds of stuff in here. We probably don't want this inside of our cinematic preview. We can go into game mode in this viewport by pressing the G key. That will hide all of those editor related icons, so we get a true representation of what our scene will look like. We can get those back again if we want. If we press the G key, they'll come right back. So just G key to toggle those on and off. All right, our viewport is set up. Across the very bottom here, it says no active level sequencer detected. We need to open the sequencer editor to get some more controls in this viewport, such as playback controls, etc. So how do we open a level sequence? There's a couple different ways we could do that. Probably the most common across the top here, I should say when you're first getting started, this is probably the most common. The cinematics button here at the very top, if you click this option, it's going to give us a couple options in here that we can choose from. At the very bottom, I'm going to work my way up from the bottom here, there's add matinee, which is the legacy way of creating cinematics in Unreal. We have plenty of documentation on matinee, but since this is a sequencer tutorial series, we're going to stick to sequences. Directly above that, we have add master sequence, which we'll talk a little bit later down the road, but this is pretty useful if you're working on large teams and have created a storyboard and know every shot that you want and every angle and how long they are. A master sequence is pretty cool, and we'll show you how that works a little bit later in this series. Directly above that, we have the add level sequence. So let's go ahead and select this, because this is going to create a new level sequence asset and place an instance of it inside of our level. So let's go ahead and select this. It's going to ask us where do we want to save it and the name. Let's go ahead and add it to our cinematics folder. And we'll call it master. Like so, and then choose save. And once it's done, it will open the sequencer editor, which is probably not very useful right in the middle of our viewport. So if you have a secondary monitor, you could drag it off screen. Or a workflow that I like to use, I just drag the tab here by the tab and dock it down here next to the content browser so that I can cycle between them like so. It's typically where I use it. Then you can stretch this up or down or however you'd like. So now that we are working inside of our master level sequence here, we now have options inside of the viewport to play our scene, which has nothing in it at the moment. But you can see our timeline actually working. We could go to the front of the scene, we can go to the end of the scene, step through keyframes, etc. It also says what shot we're currently working on, which is the master at this point. Directly below that, inside of the sequencer editor is what we're looking at. On the right here, where our timeline is, this is referred to as the tracks area. This is where you're going to be adding keyframes. You can get around inside this area by right-clicking and dragging. You can hold the control key and press the mouse wheel up to zoom in. Mouse wheel down with control held down will zoom out. So zooming in and zooming out. Quick tip here, if you get all the way zoomed in and you want to go to the top level, you can press the home key to zoom all the way out and it will center up your project. Now there's two markers in here. There's a green and a red. As you would expect, the green is go. That's where you start from. The red is stop. So it's only going to play what is inside of these playback ranges here. So if I were to play, you should see it will stop at 150. So you can drag these however you want. You can move them around the start and the end. But know that whatever inside of this playback range is what's going to play in your cinematic. Over on the left, we have the tree view or tracks window. This is where you're going to add the different types of tracks that you're going to be using to create your content. So if we go to the Add button, you can see there's a bunch of different options here for events and shots and camera cuts and play rates. And we're going to use quite a few of these as we go along. But this is where you would go to add those right here. Directly above that, there's a toolbar, sequencer toolbar. We are not going to get into all the options here, the bells and whistles. This is broken down in the documentation if you would like to see what all of these do. We'll get into a couple of them a little bit later. But if you'd like to see what all of these do, feel free to check out the documentation. There's a breakdown for what all of these are. Before we close out this video, I wanted to talk about the selling point of Sequencer, the elevator pitch of why Sequencer is so cool, is that it is a non-linear editor. So we could have several different shots on our master sequence here for our sequence, and we can arrange those how we see fit. So if, say, for example, we have one shot in this location, one shot here, and one shot here, we could take those shots and move them around and arrange them however we want. As part of our playback, which is really, really cool. It's something you couldn't do in Matinee. Matinee, everything was done in a particular level. With level sequences, they are self-contained assets, so they are not bound to a particular level. In fact, you can create a level sequence, save it in the content browser, open up a new level, and then drag that level sequence into the new level. So it's really, really cool that you can do that. To demo that shot thing that I was talking about a minute ago, let's actually create a shot and plop it into our master sequence here. So I'm going to go to the content browser before we use the cinematic way of adding a level sequence, which added it to the level. We're going to go to the cinematics folder. There's our master sequence. We're going to right click and we're going to go under animation and choose level sequence. You can also get to this from the add button under animation, level sequence as well, or right click. We're going to add a level sequence, and we're going to call this shot underscore 01. So, and if we go back to Sequencer now, if we go to the tree view over here and we click the add button, let's add a shot track. See what this does. So shot track has been added. There's a camera here. There's a plus sign. If we go to the plus sign, we can add a shot. So let's click this button. Don't want to add master, but there's the shot one that we just created. Let's go ahead and add that. Now it's going to add it wherever the location of your marker is, so it added it at a random 133 frame. But you can drag this and move this wherever you want on the timeline, which is really, really cool. So you can do that. And say, for example, we had, if I select this and hit Control W, we could duplicate it so we have shot 2, Control W, so we have shot 3. You don't have to necessarily do this. I'm just going to show you something real quick. If we add those shots now, so if we add shot two, and we add shot three, and I control zoom out, and I move my marker all the way to the end here, which I can do by pressing this little button here, like so. We can take shot two, and we could say, let's move shot one to the beginning, or shot two to the beginning. Let's move shot one to the end. Let's move shot three to the middle. You could do that right here inside of sequencer. So if I go all the way back to the beginning and we look at our cinematic viewport, you can see we're on shot two, come over to shot three, and come over to shot one. And then if we change our mind and we say, now let's put shot one there and let's put shot three there, we could do that as well. So it's very easy to move things around inside of sequencer on a shot track. Now these shots that you're looking at are inside the content browser as level sequence assets. They are their own self-contained assets inside of our master level sequence, which plays back all of those. Those shot one, shot two, and shot three, they do not exist in the level. Only our master sequence, which is selected here in the world outliner, is inside of the level. And that contains shot two, shot one, and shot three. So it'll play back those even though they are not in the level. And the last thing that we'll show real quick before we close out this video, shot one, shot two, and shot three, I can dive into those just by double-clicking on them here inside of sequencer. So if I double-click on this, we are now inside of shot one, and we can start editing the content for shot one. It's still inside the master. In fact, we can jump back up to the master level by clicking this breadcrumb here, and we can see the sequence as a whole, or we can work on individual shots. So we can go into shot one, we can go to shot three and work on that, or we can go to shot two and work on that. It's very, very easy to manipulate and work with individual shots within a overall or overarching cinematic sequence. So with all of that, that's the primer for Sequencer. That's my elevator pitch and why it's cool. There's a bunch of other things that you'll see that make Sequencer so cool as we start to go along here. But that's going to do it for this video. We're going to pick it back up in the next video where we start creating our first shot. We're going to add a character. We're going to animate that character. We're going to add a camera, add some camera movement. Play with some film back settings and focus settings, and by the end of the next video, we're going to have our first shot done. So let's pause here. Let's pick it back up in the next video. Thank you guys for watching.